What's up, Discovery Church? How you guys doing today? Good to see you. Good to see you. I'm seeing a lot of some of our 8 a.m. crew. You get a pass this time. You get the pat. You need to go back to the 8 a.m. next week. No, I'm kidding. I'm glad you guys have joined us today for our continuation of the series, The Last Words of Jesus. It's a 7-week series. This is week number 3. We're going through all the Gospels. There's 7 final statements. And really, I believe one of the most powerful sermons that Jesus ever preached was his sermon on the cross and the power of these words that were on the cross and what he shared, even in his dying moments and his dying breaths and his most painful day, he's still teaching us. And these principles and what he's sharing, these words from the cross, these statements from the cross, they give us some insight on how to handle our painful day, our bad days, all our difficult seasons, because Jesus endured, for he endured the cross for the joy set before him. And not only did he endure that painful, his worst day ever, but, I mean, he was victorious. He rose from the dead. So I don't know about you. I don't know about you, but I want all my painful seasons and suffering and difficult experiences, I want to have my own resurrection experience. I want my pain to have purpose. I want to have purpose in every season, whether it's difficult or not. I want there to be a resurrection experience. In order for me to do that, I need to do it Jesus' way. And so Jesus is sharing some principles of how he endured, of how he was victorious in his most painful day, on the worst day of his life. And we're in statement number 3 today. In this series, we're in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. It is the theme verse we're using for the series. Let me read it for you. I'm reading out the Message paraphrase. It says, keep your eyes on Jesus. And that's what we're doing here for 7 weeks leading up to Easter Sunday, actually. We're keeping our eyes on the cross. And I really hope you're excited about Easter already, you guys. You'll hear more about it coming up and more at the end of this service. I'll tell you a little bit. It says that Jesus, he who both began and finished the race we're in, study how he did it. Okay, he was victorious. He endured it. He did. He won. He endured the most difficult day, the most painful day of his life. We're going to study how he did it because we want to endure. We want to be victorious. Because he never lost sight of where he was headed. And I think one of the things we're discovering here, you guys, in this series is that it's really easy for us to lose sight, isn't it? In our painful days, in our bad times, in our bad days and bad experiences, it's so easy for us to lose sight and get distracted. It says he never lost sight of where he was headed, that exhilarating finish in and with God. He could put up with anything along the way to that finish line, along the way to heaven. He knew where he was going. He could put up with the cross, shame, whatever. And now he's there in the place of honor right alongside God. So we're in our third statement today, and I want to give you a little, just again, recap with you. The background is of course, Jesus suffering. He's been through beatings, shame, mockery, smacked with canes and fists and crown of thorns and whipped. And this wasn't just any whip. This was the cat of nine tails, right? So it had these nine, it was a whip with 9 lashes on it. So every time they hit him, it would leave 9 open wounds. And so he got 39 lashings is what he got. So that's 351 open wounds. He's just mangled is what he is. And so here at this point that we see Jesus making this statement, he's in his final breaths. He's fatigued. He's got so much blood loss. He's almost, he could be delirious even. He should be, but he's even using his energy to kind of to still teach us. And he preaches, I think, one of the most powerful messages ever from the cross here. And in the first 3 statements, it shows Jesus' incredible love for other people. It was like his love for others was the focus. The first statement we studied was, Father, forgive them. He's talking about the people who just crucified him, the people that just put the nails in his hands and beat him and whipped him, and the crowd just mocking him. Father, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing. He's demonstrating his love for his persecutors. And then the second statement was a demonstration of love to the thief that was hanging with him. He said, today you'll be with me in paradise. And then the third statement is another statement of love that he's sharing. And this time it's not to a stranger. It's someone very close to home. And we go to the Gospel of John to find this statement is the third statement that Jesus made. It's actually this is the only gospel that has this statement that Jesus made. It's only found in John. And John, he's the kind of guy that likes to watch his own highlight reel. You know what I'm saying? John's the kind of guy he likes to check himself out a little bit. It's kind of funny. You read John a little bit, and John's in a lot of John. You know what I mean? And you're gonna see in a moment, John chapter 19, what I'm talking about. It says, near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there, he just stopped in the middle of his pain and noticed mom. And the disciple whom he loved, which was John. I think it's just funny. John, all throughout the gospel, he just writes himself in as, I'm the one he loves. You know, just, John's funny, man. He makes me laugh. He's standing nearby. Jesus said to his mother, dear woman, here's your son, gesturing to John. And by the way, woman is not it's not like a derogatory, it's not like a mean word. It's not like today. If I want to get my wife mad, I call her woman, right? Woman! You know, that's not good. Don't do that. It's not the same thing, okay? This is the same terminology today would be ma'am. It's a respectful term is what he's actually calling. It's ma'am, this is your son. And he turned to his disciple, John, and he says, here's your mother. And from that time on, this disciple took her into his home, which tradition tells us was about 12 years. John, from that time on, took Mary into his home at the statement that Jesus made in the middle of his blood loss and dying breaths, in the middle of his own pain, he again notices others. He looks down and he notices mom, broken. I don't know if you've ever thought about the experience of the mother losing her son, seeing him mangled and beaten. And the Bible says he was marred beyond he was just disfigured. No one could tell it was him, but I bet you one person did. I bet you Mary knew that was her boy. Crying, broken. And he notices mom, and then he begins to think, oh no, what about mom? What is she going to do when I'm gone? Jesus is the oldest son, and he has a responsibility now to his mom. I don't know about you, but I'm not thinking about anyone else much when I'm in pain. I'll just be honest, you know, I get very selfish when I'm in pain. I get one of the most severe man colds you have ever seen. I mean, you guys know what a man cold is? You guys know? It's a cold, okay? It just something happens when it gets to the, you know, male chromosomes, and it does something to us. I tell you, I need to be pampered and taken care of, and I'm just not thinking about other people very much here. But here Jesus is. He's again looking at the needs of his mom. And what he's doing here, you might just dismiss this. This is just like housekeeping, like, oh, Jesus is just trying to, you know, tidy up stuff before he leaves. But Jesus never says anything without purpose. And here again, we're finding out how Jesus endured. What was going through his mind? How did he process? What was his process of dealing with the most difficult day of his life? And if we can tap into the principle that he's sharing with us here in including his mom in looking at the needs and being a little bit sensitive to the needs around us, we can get the power to endure our most painful day. And what he's showing, Jesus is showing the deep concern of God, the deep concern of Christ himself over your pain. He cares for you. He cares for your pain. Write this down this way. Here's the principle. Number three, be sure to take care of those closest to you. When you're going through pain, when you're dealing with your difficult season, be sure to take care of those who are closest to you. Turn to someone and say, pay attention. Come on, pay attention. Pay attention. Don't, because your pain may be blinding you from your purpose. I mean, you know that. Let me say that again. Your pain may be blinding you from your purpose. It may be preventing you from doing that which God has called you to do. You ever get into some pain or difficult season and you start to scale it back and scale it back because of that? See, look, God's still working. God still has purpose in the middle of that pain, in the middle of that season. I promise if you'll just look up and look around, God wants to use you. There's pain. There's purpose in the middle of your pain. Don't be blind to your responsibilities because of your pain either. You still have, and Jesus is recognizing that he is responsible for his mom. And he takes some time to be aware of the needs around him. It was a while ago. I had a bad church day. I don't know, you guys don't have that very much, but I had a bad church day maybe a couple years ago, and nothing was going right? It was just like things just in the worship experience, even my message, I just feel like it just was not connecting, and I wasn't making any sense or something, and so I'm beating myself up at the end of the day, and I'm like, oh, just frustrated, just like bad day, bad work day for Pastor Jason, okay? You have bad work days. I got some bad work. I was having a bad day. And so this didn't go right. Nothing went right. There was all these little problems that kind of came up. And I'm in the car, and I'm waiting for the kids now. Kids get in the car. Wife gets in the car. And I'm like, just get me out of here, you know? And I'm trying to get out of the parking lot, and I'm like, oh, go ahead. Go ahead. Bless you. Okay, go. Blessing. Just acting like I'm blessing them as I'm like, okay, God bless you. And it's not good when the pastor peels out of the parking lot. Get out of here. I'm honestly frustrated, and my girl Abby, my middle girl, she starts asking me some questions. She notices I'm frustrated. She says, "Dad, how long ago did you start Discovery Church?" And I said, "Well, it was about 2 years ago, a little over 2 years ago now." And she says, "Wow, well, how many people did you start it with?" And I said, "Well, it was like 8 of us in the living room, but we started with probably like 34 people on our launch team." She said, "Wow, well, how many people were there today, Dad?" I said, "There's about 500 people there today." "Wow, God's done a lot, hasn't he, Dad?" I'm like, "Let's go to Chuck E. Cheese, come on." Girl, I was ready to transmit my trauma onto my kids. And this is what we do. This is what we do when we're having pain or a difficult day. Instead of taking care of those closest to us, we transmit our trauma thinking that they're going to absorb it. They're supposed to absorb it. And we're not really aware or sensitive to the needs around us. Not Jesus. In his pain, he took care of those closest to him. He thought, "What is mom going to do? What's mom? Don't transmit your trauma. Take care of them." And I always believe that awareness is half the battle. If you can understand what we tend to do and expose it, then that's half the battle. You can know how to fight it because there are some selfish tendencies that prevent us from seeing the needs around us and kind of get us just looking in and blind to the purpose and blind to the destiny and blind to even our responsibilities that we can put on the back burner because we're having a bad day or we're experiencing some sort of bad season. Awareness will always, I think, open our eyes to the issues at hand. Which, by the way, can I just say too, that the reason why Jesus was even able to see, the reason why he was able to be aware of the needs of all these people around him was because he had self-awareness. Like he knew who he was and why he was there. He knew his purpose and his identity, and because of that, he could see clearly through the lens of his identity the people around him. Look, if you do not know who you are, if you're not self-aware and you don't have your identity, then it's gonna give you a false filter in the people around you. I'm going to come back to that. That's important to understand that Jesus knew who he was. He knew why he was suffering. He knew where he was going, and that gave him the proper perspective to see the needs around him. Okay, follow that. I'm going to come back to that. Okay, there's three desires that I want to share with you. James doesn't pull any punches. There's these desires, these selfish desires that get in the way of us looking outside of ourselves. And James says in chapter 4, verse 1, he says, "What causes all those fights and quarrels you get into? What's the cause of all that? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you?" What desires? I'm glad you asked. The Bible is very clear. There's three desires, three main desires that you and I have, And when we have them out of priority, these desires, they're going to cause conflict every time in your life. And they're going to blind you to the purpose God has for you in every season. Let me give you the three desires that will blind you to the needs around you and to the purpose God has for you in that season. Number one, write these down. Number one is the desire to have. The desire to have. We want to have things. We want more toys. Give me more things. That's materialism. Possession. Just more. Verse 2 in the Living Bible of James chapter 4 says, "You want what you don't have. You long for what others have." Isn't that true? I mean, and that's really easy to long and become coveting other people's stuff. It's easy in our culture today because, I mean, you got all the commercials, you got advertisements, people telling you what you need, telling you what you don't have. You got social media too, which you thought you had it good, and then you look on social media and you go, dang it, I don't have that. I didn't get that. I didn't go there. They had a nice dinner. Where's my dinner, honey? You know, you just start to compare. When we start loving things, you guys, we're supposed to use things. Things are okay. Do you guys know things are okay? God doesn't mind you having things. The Bible actually says in 1 Timothy that God gave everything for your enjoyment. Everything. Like, you're supposed to enjoy things. God don't mind you enjoying things. You're supposed to use things and love people. See, the problem is when you start loving things, you start using people. You get it backwards. It becomes twisted. You start loving things and you start using people. You start manipulating people. You start controlling people to put them on the board of your life where you want them to get the right things and the outcomes that you want. The desire to have. I need it. I want it. It's a materialism. It's possession. It leaves you empty every time. Here's the second desire that's blinding. It's blinding us. Is the desire to feel. The desire to feel. I want to feel good. I want to feel good. I want to feel happy. I like being comfortable. I like it. I don't know about you. I like comfort. I do. I got my comfort sweats at home. I'm going to get into after this. You know what I'm saying? I got my comfort chair. I'm going to get into that. I like comfort. I want to be satisfied. Verse 3 says, "You want only what will give you pleasure." Look again, it's not wrong to enjoy life, but when pleasure becomes your number one goal, you're going to have conflict. You'll end up hurting yourself. You're going to have conflict if pleasure becomes, I want to feel good. I want to be comfortable. When that becomes the priority of your life, you will have conflict. The desire to have, the desire to feel good are two of the desires that when thwarted, when prioritized wrong, it's going to produce conflict and it's going to blind you. All right, and it's really easy to get into this too when you're in these seasons of pain and difficulty, when you're enduring a season. Here's the third desire that kind of gets us off track, and that's the desire to be. I want to be somebody. I want to be a big shot. I want to be the boss man. I want to be rich. I want to be. This is pride, power, prominence, prestige, popularity. This is just I want to be number one. It's that Frank Sinatra song, right, that the President Trump had, and when the First Lady and him danced. You guys remember? I did it my way. I did it my way. We're in the generation of I did it my way. Everyone wants to do it their way and then go, look at me. Watch me. Watch me. Watch me. Hey, they want everyone. The kids, when they were younger, they go, watch me, Daddy. Watch me, Daddy. And then we got adults now still saying, watch me. Watch me. And maybe we don't say it like that, but we say it in different ways. We say, watch me, watch my post, watch me. Watch me, watch my clothes, watch what I drive, watch what I put in my house, watch what kind of house, watch me. And look again, those things aren't necessarily bad in and of themselves. It's when they become your tool to impress people, your need to satisfy something that you have to be, that you got your identity wrong. Your be is not in your things. Your be is in Christ. That's your identity is in Christ. So when you get your priorities mixed up, it's going to blind you. It's going to prevent you from really, like in what we're studying here, to contextualize it, it's going to prevent you from being able to endure those bad seasons, those bad days. Because if you want to really study how Jesus did it, and do likewise, we have to be able to be in that season, to be able to be in that pain, and to be self-aware enough to be aware of the people around us and the needs they have. And that through that somehow I'm given ability. I'm given strength to endure my difficult season. James goes on to say the reason why our desires aren't fulfilled when they're lacking priority. In verse 2 and 3 of chapter 4, he says, you don't get what you desire because you don't ask God. And when you ask God, you don't receive because you ask with the wrong motives. The number one reason why we don't have what we want is because we don't pray. And you know what? Prayerlessness is in itself pride. Do you know that? Prayerlessness in itself is a prideful stance that says, I don't need God. I don't need Him to come through. I don't need to ask God for anything. I got this. My life is fine. I'm okay with my life. I can take care of my own needs. The desire to have, the desire to feel, the desire to be. And again, when you're enduring that season and when you're in pain, it's really easy to default to those things and to again transmit trauma onto the people who are closest to us and the people that we're supposed to love the most, instead of protecting them and taking care of them, instead of blowing up and mistreating those closest to us. The third way to live, to endure, to be victorious in that season, is to be aware of people. Be aware of their needs. Be sensitive to them. There are five things. I want to give you five things that you need to be aware of. If you want to do it how Jesus did it, okay, and endure the most painful days in your painful seasons that are maybe yet on the horizon, you need to do it how Jesus did it. I'm going to give you five things that we need to be aware of the people around us, okay? Here's number one. Write it down. We need to be aware of God's view of them. Be aware of God's view of them. Before you mistreat anyone, be sure you know how much God loves people. Like all people. Of every race, of every class, of every background, of every sin type. There's no sin type that God does not love more or less. Do you know that? And I don't know where your propensity of judgment goes. Everyone has their own classifications of why they can discount and devalue other people. But God doesn't do that. God loves everybody the same. And there's this very popular verse that we all know, John 3:16. For God so loved what? The world, the ugly, sinful, beat down world. The world. That He gave His only Son. Be careful how you treat or mistreat people. We got to place a value on them because God values them. God values them. And the value that is on people is not what other people put on them. It's not what you think they are. It's what God thinks they are. It's actually the price that was paid for that person. And the price that was paid for every person was the life of Jesus. So we need to put value. We need to honor people, to hold. Honor means to hold up in value. So if you value God, you need to value people. You need to value what He values. It's amazing to me how we can treat some people one way and others a different way, just on how they look or what they believe or what their political preference or what their sin type is, that we can treat them differently without value just because they identify as a homosexual or just because they have a different sin issue, an addiction, and that we can somehow devalue them because of that. Shame on us. God loves the world. He's placed value on them. He paid the debt. Let me give you an example. This is a $20 bill. Who wants a $20 bill? Come on, this is an IQ question here. A few of you, okay? I don't know. What's okay? So how about, let me do this, right? Right? Crumble this thing up. Who wants it now? Are you sure? It's crumbled. Are you sure? How about, okay, wait. How about now? Why? I crumbled on it. I stepped on it. Why? Because you know it's still worth $20, huh? This is still lunch right here, ain't you? Someone has not put down their hand. They're like, pass your hand up first. My hand was up first. No, it's my lunch, bro. Put that hand down. Look, and people matter to God, dropped, crumbled, beat down, stepped on. They still have the same value to God. Be aware of God's view on people, because it's really easy, especially when you're going through a bad time, to really beat down on other people's issues and belittle them. Here's the second thing we need to be aware of, and that is be aware of the power of your words. Be aware of the power of your words. Man, it's so easy. It's so easy just to get, and this is like, when I'm going through a bad day or a difficult season, it can be easy for me to just let my words get away from me, but we underestimate the power that words actually are. Do you believe your words have power? Do you believe that, man? Because the Bible says it does. In fact, the Bible says that your words can change history, that your words can heal, that your words can forgive, that your words can divide, that your words can discord. Like, there is the power of life and death or in our words. Proverbs 18:21, the tongue is the power of life and death, and those who love it will eat its fruit. How many believers speak negative words about themselves? Obsessing about our mistakes, focusing on our problems, fostering self-fulfilling atmosphere of doubt and denial, feeling that our adversaries are so much stronger and bigger, and I am so much weaker and little. Be careful that when you're enduring that season, that your very words don't become a self-fulfilling prophecy to the people that you love. You need to be careful of your words. Be mindful that your words have power. Your words can become self-fulfilling prophecies for life or for death. And so in your marriage and when you come home and you're transmitting that trauma to your kids or to your spouse or on your coworkers, and you wonder why your relationships are torn up and messed up, and it's because your words are self-fulfilling prophecies. Be careful. There is power in your words. Ephesians 4:29 says, don't let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful to building others up according to their needs. Simply put, forget about what you want to say and focus on what they need. That's what you need to do. That's how you be aware of the needs around you, that it may benefit those who listen. Here's some ideas on how you can use your words, even in the middle of your bad season, in a tough day. Let people know you need them. Let people know that you need them. Let people know you love them, you need them, you're thankful for them. Compliment them in front of people. Like, compliment the people that are closest to you that you love. Compliment them. Let them know they're appreciated in front of other people. And defend those closest to you. Don't attack them. Defend them. Be aware of the power of your words. Here's number three. We need to be aware of what we did. A lot of times our bad seasons, our pains, comes from relational stuff. It just is. Most of our issues are relational. We need to be aware of what we did. But when we're going through a bad time, what's the first thing we try to do? We look for someone to blame, don't we? That's a human nature. You see it at the youngest age. My boy Caleb, we were going out to eat, and he likes to play the crane games. I always tell him no. All the kids, they're like, come on, please. I'm like, it's like a waste of $1.50. And my wife is so, no, let him. It's just $1.50. I'm like, ah. So here they go, they're playing the crane game, and he's playing, and of course he doesn't win anything. The claw comes back up empty, and he goes, somebody bump my arm. Man, I'm going to bump you in your head. No one hits your arm. You know, he's just looking for someone to blame. It's like, it's human instinct. I played football with this one guy who, we called him Stone Hands. He couldn't catch nothing, man. It was funny. It was funny. It became funny, because at first it was, you know, he said something. Every time he dropped the ball, he would say something, and we laughed about it so much, he just kept on saying it. But every time he dropped the ball, he'd go, oh, man, the sun was in my eyes. The sun was in my eyes. He jogged back. I'm like, ah, it's dark out. And he's like, the sun was in my eyes. We looking for someone to blame. We need to be aware of what we did. We see ourselves in light of our intentions, but we see others in light of their actions. We need to be aware of what we did. And if you have trouble figuring out what you did all the time, like you don't know why, what in the world's going on, you don't know what you did, this next scripture is for you. If you want to know if you're ready to be in a healthy relationship, whether that's a spouse, coworkers, leadership, any of these things, well, the way you begin figuring that out is by looking in the mirror and taking a good look at who you are. That's where you start. Look at Matthew chapter 7, starting at verse 1 with me. It says, "Do not judge, or you too will be judged. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you." Verse 3, "Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, 'Let me take that speck out of your eye,' when all the time there is a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye." Jesus is saying here, don't look past your issues. Take a good look in the mirror. Like before you try to blame, like take a good look in the mirror. You are worried about some dust in that other person's eye when all the while you got a 2x4 in yours. Okay? You want to know if you're ready for leadership, ready to be in a healthy relationship. Well, you need to be able to look in the mirror and say, "I am who I am because of my own choices, because of my own attitude, I am where I am because of me." That's what you need to be able to look in the mirror and be able. But we live in a world where you don't need to take responsibility for anything, do you? We live in a society that, I mean, people are suing McDonald's because they burnt their lip and their lap, you know, on the coffee. They sue, or you know, people will sue someone who's trying to break into a house and they broke their leg while they're breaking into a house, then they sue the person and win. We hear these ridiculous, like, lawsuits, you guys, and for excuses why we act the way we act, and it's all nonsense. Like, our kids can do no wrong, right? Our kids don't do anything wrong. It's the coach's fault. It's the teacher's fault. We need a new teacher. Because it ain't Johnny. Johnny can't do no wrong. Our culture is not screaming out that we're accountable for anything about ourselves. Our culture is saying we're victims. We're a victim somehow. But even on the cross, Jesus never demonstrated that victim mentality. Did he have the right to? He probably could have. But he never blamed and demonstrated a victim mentality. His self-awareness is... My self-awareness is going to affect my other's awareness. It's going to filter it one way or the other. Let me give you a few questions to ask yourself to see if you're ready for healthy relationships. These aren't in your notes. Let me give you four things real quick. Number one, have I looked in the mirror and am I willing to take responsibility for who I am? Have you looked in the mirror and taken responsibility for who you are? Number two, ask yourself, do I hurt people? Or am I too easily hurt by them? Because hurt people. And we live in a broken and beat up world, you guys. And there's pain in this world and there's many hurting people on this planet. And the reality is these hurt people often hurt people and they're often hurt by people. Do I hurt people or am I too easily hurt by them? Third question you need to ask yourself is, do I overreact to small things in a relationship situation? Do you overreact to the small things? Do you have a short fuse? Do you kind of blow up really easily? Okay, these are just questions. If you're ready to be this type of person, to be self-aware and others aware, especially when you're in pain, you need to ask yourself these questions. Here's the fourth one, and that is, do I lift up or do I tear people down? Do I lift people up or do I tear people down? Be aware of what you did. And some say, well, it really isn't my fault, Pastor. Like, it's not. It's their fault. Even if that's true, that's not going to help you change the situation. Which leads to the fourth thing that you should be aware of. You be aware of God's view of them. Be aware of the power of your words. Be aware of what you did. Number four, be aware of what you should do. Be aware of what you should do in every bad day, in every painful season. Focus on the actions and the attitudes you can control. Let me spell it out to you. The only thing that you can control, the only one you can control is you. What can you control? I'm glad you asked. You can control your attitude. You want to know what your attitude? What will get you out of that painful season faster than anything is the attitude of humility. If you just humble yourself, that season will be a lot shorter. It can be a whole lot longer if you don't. The attitude of humility, and then the action. What actions? Bless others. Like in the middle of your bless those who persecute you. I'm telling you, God likes it, and He will bless your socks off if you do. If you have a humble attitude and you bless those who persecute you, I'm telling you, God likes it. Look at 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8 and 9. It says, finally, all of you live in harmony with one another. Be sympathetic, love as brothers. Be compassionate and humble. Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult. Just because you're having a bad day doesn't give you the right to make everyone's day bad. No. But with a blessing, bless others. Because this is what you were called, so that you may inherit a blessing. You see, God wants to bless you. And so many times we're blinded by our pain and we can't see the purpose, and there's destiny right in the middle of that pain. Like, God wants to bless you right in the middle of that circumstance, right in that season, which leads to the fifth thing that you need to be aware of. You need to be aware of what God will do. And that speaks of faith. Some of you are in a tough season right now, and today you dragged yourself to church. Listen, you need to be aware of what God will do. This isn't done. Hey, it's not over. You may have to suffer for a season. You may have to endure for a season. But what enabled Jesus to endure for the joy set before Him? There's a resurrection coming. It's not over. This pain will not last forever. Be aware of what God will do. God's grace is available to those who humble themselves. Look at this, 1 Peter 5, verse 5 and 6. It said, God opposes the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. Okay, those are my options there. Okay, so do I want to be opposed by God? Or do I want God's grace and His unmerited favor? Well, if those are my options, then here, I'm going to humble myself. Therefore, under God's mighty hand, so that He may lift me up in the right time, in the right season, in the right time. When you come to God and you empty yourself, God likes it. When you humble yourself, actually, that's what salvation is. That's all salvation is. Salvation is just humbling yourself before God, saying, I cannot do it. I don't have the answers. I can't fix it. And only You can. Can we start right there? Can we bow our heads all across this worship center? Let's go to God in prayer.